You gotta look there.
Are we?
Yeah, don't forget to look at the right camera. Not the wrong one, but definitely the right one.
The right one.
And it looks like we are live, so why don't you address our fans and tell them what's going on here, Gordon.
Hey, Internet, got special guest today for you, Ryan Schlieper. You remember him from the very early days of the Full Nerd. We finally got Ryan back on.
Yeah.
We're going to be talking about Super X5, which is super awesome. It is super awesome. We're going to be kicking it some old school. We're going to be talking about his build. I want to hear about this build. Yeah. And he's got a special surprise, something I don't know about, Adam doesn't know about. Nobody knows about it. Apparently, it's a super special surprise. We're going to hope it's a surprise.
I hope so. I hope you guys are. It's definitely cool.
Okay.
Well, we got E. Lopez here. We got Phil. We got Gary.
So bring your PC audio questions and old school.
Big time, PC talk.
E. Lopez says, it's Mr. Sound Blaster time.
There we go.
You should put that on your business card.
I, you know what, man? It's business card time. I got to refresh them for CES, so I think I'm going to put Mr. Sound Blast. I'm going to give E. Lopez credit for that one.
That's a good one.
And Whiskey Omega over on Twitch says that they're breaking out their Sound Blaster 16 from his 286.
Oh, dude.
Yeah.
That's what I'm here for. I'm here for that old school funk.
Did we talk about it last time? I had a micro channel. Sound Blaster card.
Yes. So yeah, you're legit, man. You got the card.
Eric is wondering if the surprise is donuts.
Donuts over there.
You know what? It's almost as cool as donuts, maybe, because donuts are pretty awesome.
Okay, so actually, last time I was at Creative,
low bars donuts.
Yeah, well, last time I was at Creative, you had some fresh baked goods.
Yes.
So if the surprise with that, I wouldn't be too bad
that
either.
That bakery's pretty awesome, too. Yeah.
All right. Cool. I think we are ready to get going.
Yeah.
Gordon, let me. Queued
I'm
up.
Not screwing that up. Ryan Schlieper.
It's Schlieper.
Schlieper.
Is it Schlieper? Yeah. Okay.
Schlieper. I think I messed it up too on the last show.
I
think it said Schlieper.
It's interchangeable. I've been, as long as you don't put an extra L in it, because I always get Schleppler. And I'm like, where's that other L coming from?
Schlieper.
You know? Yeah. Schlieper. You know what it means?
No.
Well, it means scissor maker or blade maker in German.
Huh.
So my ancestors were blade makers.
Wow.
I like to say they made swords, but I really think it's scissors.
And that's awesome.
And shears and stuff. Yeah, but I'm like, yeah, they were sword makers, man. Schliep is to cut, I think.
Oh, interesting.
So, yeah, cut maker.
That's awesome.
I was going to tell an FBI murders. Story. So I know this FBI agent from work before, and the story he told us, it was like, yeah, so he's in the academy. This is so long ago that Hoover was still alive.
Okay.
He goes up and he goes, "What's your name?" You know, Hoover to this guy says, "It's Richard Smith, sir." And he's like, "There's already a Richard in the FBI. Your name is Rick."
Nice.
So everybody's like, "How come you're called Rick?" And like, there from that day on, everybody's like, "Yeah.
You've been anointed. Your name is now no longer yours."
That's yes. By the owner. I think I've heard that story many times from different not from that story, but just people whose name gets changed.
Yeah, it happens a lot with Richard and the really common names, right? Like people have them modified or neutered down.
See, there's no way to do that with Adam. I've had like somebody try to have Addy stick, like ADY, but then it just doesn't.
You don't want that.
Well, I get Gordo, Gordy, G-Man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
G-Man's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
That's good.
Got some Half-Life love action going on.
Also, Eric on YouTube says their first time watching live. They usually listen to
all right.
the podcast.
So that means you can ask questions. And you got your name thrown in there.
Yeah, and hopefully I don't scare you away.
No, we're glad to have you. All right, let's do this.
All right.
All right, ready?
Yep.
In this episode of The Full Nerd, Super X-Fi. I messed it up already. So I had to look down. It's like only one word. Right, here we go. In this episode of The Full Nerd, Super X-Fi, a special... Oh, damn it. What is the second one? Okay, this time it's going to work. In this episode of The Full Nerd, Super X-Fi, old school computers, and a special surprise.
Oh, crap. I hit the wrong one.
Oh, man. Do I have to do it again?
Dang it.
That was pretty epic.
Oh, I'm sorry. You got to do it again. That was
really?
Me. Dang
you
it.
Got it this time.
I'm sorry.
In this episode.
Wait, sorry. Okay. All right. We're good.
In this episode of The Full Nerd, Super X-Fi. Damn it. Got it now. I got it now this time. See, he messed me up. I had it right.
Yeah, right.
Adam had it the wrong way. He messed me up. Adam
sorry.
Adam messed up.
In this episode of The Full Nerd, Super X-Fi, old school computers, and a very special surprise. All right.
Yeah, you got it.
Pegboard. I don't think anybody's ever figured out who that is.
Nope.
Who? Oh, look at that. My name's in there. That's pretty sick. I feel special.
Oh wait, you didn't do the hand thing. Welcome to The Full Nerd, episode 77. He didn't do it. He's supposed to give me the signal.
Gotta go like this.
Do it. Yeah. What up?
Welcome
what up?
To the full. Yeah, he was just like
just throwing some sides.
Go.
Like, what are you? Welcome are you
to the full
to
nerd episode 77. We are having fun here. I'm your host Gordon Mong with special guest Ryan Schlieper.
Hey, yeah.
Good. Who, by the way, his family made Excalibur. You don't even know that.
That is not
Ryan, yes. Of course, from Creative Labs. But Adam, let's get Adam Patrick Murray controlling the vertical and horizontal.
The man.
So funny inside baseball. Our template, that I use every week. And then I just kind of change the numbers and the whoever's on. The template we got finalized last when you were there.
Yeah.
So where it says special guest Ryan.
Yeah.
That is always in there. So every time I have to go in and change it, it always starts with Ryan. And this time I opened it up and was like, I don't gotta change it.
That's
he's
awesome.
Back.
See, it was foreshadowing.
Good to have you back.
Good it's to be lazy.
Best when Adam awesome doesn't have to do more work.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, I love that. I never change that. You have to keep my name in there. I want to be on your mind every time you edit that.
Every single time.
So, of course, for people who don't know, Ryan is, of course, Mr. Sound Blaster. A viewer gave him that nickname earlier.
Mr. Sound Blaster.
He is a longtime Creative Labs.
Yep.
Well, product manager?
I got a question because I was looking this up earlier. It's just Creative, right? What's Creative Labs?
Okay.
Am I too old school?
Nah, man. It's all good. You're right. So, Creative is the parent company.
Okay.
The mega company. That's the Singaporean mega company. And then Creative Labs is the U.S. office. That's our incorporation in the U.S., Creative Labs Incorporated. So that's CLI.
Okay.
CLE is Creative Labs Europe. So, and then CLA is Creative Labs Asia. So it's, you got the mothership and then you have the satellites.
Okay.
So Creative Labs is what everybody in the U.S., actually everybody in the world knows Sound Blaster was Creative Labs. And we've kind of backed away from Creative Labs, on the branding side and just kind of pushed it over to the creative side because it's a lot easier to put on a box.
Well, yeah, because I was looking at the Super X-Fi box and I was just like, wait, no, that just says Creative.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
And then, Creative is, Super X-Fi is actually a separate division of Creative too. So it's,
oh, really?
It's all under that umbrella. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, actually, yeah, I had showed the Super X-Fi over the weekend to one of my friends and he was like, oh, I, when I said X-Fi, he thought it was something else.
Yeah.
He was like, oh, I know X-Fi. And I'm like, no, you don't know Super X-Fi.
Yeah. I mean, X-Fi is, part of that old school story. That's the, when Sim talked about the kind of how the evolution of Super X-Fi came about, X-Fi is one of those steps. It's one of those iterative steps in the chain. It was a product. I mean, we did a lot of product branding around X-Fi, too. That was one of our most successful card launches,
right?
Was the X-Fi series.
Yeah, yeah, no, that was
Titanium
a solid card, right?
Yeah.
So, of course, people, we assume everybody knows what Super X-Fi is. Mm-hmm. I brought mine in, but I left it at my desk. It is a little tiny dongle.
Grab one.
Oh, really? Okay. So Adam's going to go grab one. But it's basically a little tiny dongle.
Yep.
Probably the size of a, USB flash drive.
Yeah.
And USB-C on one end, other side is another, is a 3.5 millimeter head jack.
Yep.
Plug your headphones in, although you should have certified headphones. Plug the other end into your phone or your USB-C computer, laptop. Oh, wait. Oh, yeah. We're going to open mics up.
Yeah, I might as well show the whole box.
All right.
Here, I'll do it.
Do you have a...
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't have my carry with me.
And what
Gordon's
it does
got a scary
is
knife.
It does the magical...
He was waiting to do that.
Oh, yeah.
He wanted to flick it out.
Yeah. Just... yeah. He always does that, yeah.
I'm trying not to cut
And yeah, Gordon and Mike Brown and myself, we went down to the offices a little bit ago. God, I don't even remember. I guess it was about a month ago.
Yeah, about 3 weeks ago, I think.
And yeah, got another demo, kind of an expanded thing off of what we saw at CES. And we're real glad to have it finally arrive and talk with everyone about it.
We're stoked about it. So Gordon was going into what the hardware is. You know, this is the kind of frustration-free packaging version. I don't know if it's on, there's the camera there, but not really, you know, there's a sleeve that goes over it. These are the press kits.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
But this is it. You know, this is the, do you have that other camera?
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to put it down there. I don't know. That's it. You know, the button on the top there. You're off and on, your volume control, your call receive. You got USB-C on the end there, and then you got your 3.5 on this end there. And inside of this is the chip that makes all the magic happen.
The Super X-Fi?
Super X-Fi, yeah. And, you know, what we've done, we call it headphone holography, because surround doesn't, I mean, you guys can attest to it. Surround doesn't really apply here because it's such a different, I mean, I think, I don't know, maybe you guys have a different opinion. It's different than positional surround, virtual surround, because it's emulating a room versus emulating, just putting positional audio on the speakers here. So, and it does it without that, you know, kind of pseudo reverb effect that you get. Right. You know, it's hard to explain, actually.
Yeah.
I mean, the way I always explain is the demo, you know, and when I explain the demo, people go, oh, that sounds interesting. But it's, I mean, I think it's awesome. We were talking a little bit about it.
Right. So there's two ways it works. The best way is you actually put in-ear microphones in your ear.
Yep.
And then you run a surround sound system, and it basically builds profiles for your head.
Yep.
For those speakers, right?
Yeah, it's customized hearing. So basically, we train and we create a special profile for you that basically tells the chip, this is how I hear audio. This is how I hear positional audio. This is how my ear shape and everything references audio. And then that gives the chip extra information to work with in addition to all of the channel information. And because we can take those two things and combine them, we're able to get it to the level that we're at now,
right,
which is way more intense than anything out there, I think.
And there's been solutions to try to also you know, replicate this to varying degrees of success, mostly crappy.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's kind of the secret sauce that I found, is that when you know the actual physics of how each person individually hears, and then you apply that to the room that they're in, then that's when you're able to kind of get that secret sauce that nobody else has. And it's done by, I mean, when we were creative, sure, we got the microphone thing with the frequency sweeps.
Yep.
Which was you know, like the best version you can get to map out how you hear, the physics of it. The normal consumer is just going to have this app on their phone, and it scans the ears and scans the face, builds the experience through that. And so it's actually been interesting because Gordon and I, we have both versions on our phone, and I've been able to kind of use both and try out how each one is subtly different.
Yeah, subtly different.
But yeah, it's great. I've been playing it mostly in games. Gordon, Mike, and I are actually going to tag team the review. We don't have the final review yet, but I've been mostly playing it in games, and I love it.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've worked at Creative a long time. I've heard every iteration of our technologies. And, you know, I say the story, the first time we heard it at CES last year, I was kind of like, oh, okay, yeah, you know, here we go again. You know, I love our tech, and I love what our scientists do, but I'm so jaded at this point, you know. Yeah. I'm so in it and jaded that it takes a lot to impress me. And about 30 seconds into this demo, I started laughing because I said, oh my God, you guys shocked me. You surprised me. And again, even when you guys came over, I sat down in the room, in the demo room we were doing with the final product, and I got the ear scan and did all that stuff. And I was just in the room by myself, and he was like, okay, now I'm going to do the check to make sure that your profile is accurate. And he played it through, and I was just sitting there, and I'm like, when are you going to do the check? Because I thought he was still playing it through the speakers in the room, and he wasn't. It was on my headphones. So, so to kind of rein it in here for everybody watching, what we do is we basically fool your brain into thinking that you are hearing audio with a surround sound system around you versus headphones. And it's so realistic that you kind of forget headphones are on your head. And, you know, Mr. Sim, our owner and chairman, he kind of got me stuck on this. He said, you know, your brain is trying to match where this audio is coming from. So if you're watching a movie or you're playing a game, you're in it and your brain is picking out where this audio is coming from. But if you're just kind of hanging out and listening to it in the real world, you know, the tree in front of you is making the noise. Like your brain searches for ways for where this audio's come from. So it's just so different than everything else. I've been using it for gaming too, and we're actually doing a lot of tuning just for gaming. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't know. The most impressive clip to me was the YouTube clip with the mono recording.
Yeah, Billie Holiday.
Billie Holiday singing My Funny Valentine. We took a mono recording.
Yeah.
And it basically takes a mono recording and makes it sound like you're in a nightclub with Billie Holiday and an audience from a mono single track recording. And because of the way that we're listening to the audio and the way we've customized the audio, we can extract where the microphone was in the scene, where the positional audio is. And nobody's heard anything like this before.
Yeah, you know, this kind of brings up the one thing, because I did a lot of close listening to, you know, because I figured phone-based, stereo-based source. I found that as I went back into older songs, older music that just hadn't been processed, like a lot of newer songs, it was like a little, like it's almost like over, you know, processing something that's been heavily processed. There's like there's a Merle Haggard song from like 1972 or something.
Like watching the Dukes of Hazzard or something, man. That's like
I forgot. It was, but I mean, it was like that Billie Holiday song.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Wow, this is a really. I know everybody's gonna think we're just pulling your leg here, but there are just some songs that make you think you are sitting in the audience and you would just like, my God, like the difference is night and day.
It's night and day.
And then some other ones, like you almost, and actually one thing I like about it is you have this button, if you're using it on your phone, which is where I think a lot of people are going to be
PC
doing.
And the PC too.
Yep.
Yeah. And PC, but I mean, you'll be able to push that button and turn off the effect, which I think is very useful because.
And you still have an awesome headphone amp.
Right.
So, you know, it wouldn't be good if you didn't. We went with the processing, but we also went with a really high-end headphone amp so that, you know, if you have a crappy amp, which is where a lot of people kind of lose the story. Like if you're not serious about audio, you'll be, oh, we have all this processing and we have this. And then you put a horrible headphone amp on there and then everything is pushed through a horrible headphone amp. So it's good all the way through.
Right.
So real quick, sorry, before we get too far, we do have some questions that I want to address. John Phillips, our boss, is live and watching from the other room. He's literally out there. And he's saying, so the idea is that it makes a small room sound like a Gothic cathedral. I'd say no, it's more like it's accurately placing. So for me, the weird thing is that like when you're wearing headphones, and I mean, we've worn headphones or even in-ear monitors for our whole life sometimes. And, you know, like you don't realize that the sound is constrained to right here because that's where the speaker is. So, and the best way I could describe it is that like when you hit the button to activate it, the sound goes from a flat feeling right beside your ears to out in front of you and behind you. Yeah. And like, it doesn't sound like you have speakers against your ears anymore. It sounds like those speakers are placed around you. So it's the space, but also the fact that you get the processing away from your head.
And it's modeled from that room, right? So we have a golden room model from an acoustically perfect room, you know, with a 7.2.1 system. So we have the speakers overhead as well. We have the room that you guys were in, you know, we measured that room and we calibrated for that room. And it you know, people, the most interesting thing is the way people react to bass, because the bass is actually modeled after a subwoofer that's somewhere else away from you. So now you don't hear the bass up against your head. You hear the bass as if it were in the room with you. So it gives you that cinematic feeling versus just pounding up against your ears. But it, intensifies the bass, even though it's away from you. That's my experience with it. So, so basically we're doing like a, we're recreating, instead of a headphone sound, a room audio sound. And we can blow that out to sound like a Gothic cathedral if we want, if we measure that room. And then we can apply the algorithm to that and create that. But most of the time we want to create like a theater effect or a, you know, a perfect acoustically sound room, so that it feels with headphones on that you're in a room with a surround system versus wearing headphones.
And also to confirm, I mean, this is just stereo headphones. Ruru 2 is asking, do I need 7.1 headphones? It's like, no, I've actually had those headphones that had separate drivers in there.
Yeah.
And you know, it doesn't
it's
work.
A gimmick. I'm telling you right now, there's a reason why Creative has never made a multi-speaker headphone, and it's because audio doesn't work that way.
Yeah. Also the, you know, the idea is that we hear spatial sound with, I mean, our ears are just stereo, but the idea of how the sound goes around physics, you know, and the timing delays is how we get that depth. So this is kind of just recreating that and putting that back into a
and customizing their heads. It for you. You know, customizing it for the individual.
Sorry, and real quick, Gordon, I know we got so many questions. People want to know. And Ruru2 also is asking, are there any store demos for this? They need to hear it in real life.
So the cool part about this is we have a program with this. You'll be able to hear it. We actually can do this effect to a limited degree in software on your phone. So we have a program now where if you know somebody that has a dongle, you can actually plug that dongle into your phone and it will unlock our app that we'll be launching in January. And you can sample it. You could sample anything in the player and hear it for yourself, so you can become a believer. Because believe me, you know, this is the thing I tell Gordon and Adam all the time. When you're selling audio, it's not like video. Like, this is my mantra.
Oh, yeah.
You hear this me say it all the time. You know, I wish I worked for a graphics company. I wish I could say, hey, look at picture A and picture B, and picture B is so much prettier. And
unless it's ray tracing.
Unless it's,
No.
Don't bring that into my audio.
Sorry. No, we're talking about audio.
You know, and it's easy because people see the difference. When you talk about audio, it's a challenge for everybody across the board. It has always been a challenge for audio because the experience is what you need. And so our goal is to give this experience to as many people as possible, because once you hear it, you know, you're going to want to stick with it. It's, if you're a headphone user, this is really going to change your life. And I know that sounds crazy to say. It's a very bold statement, but it is that compelling. And like Gordon said, I agree. Certain content is more suitable to it.
Right.
Yes. I mean, if you're into jazz, classical, rock, you know, it is mind-blowing. Electronica and stuff, it's a cool effect, but it's not as immersive because there's not, you know, electronica is a very flat format. Mm. There's really no depth.
So
I mean, so
and
much
I'm an electronica
of,
fan. I'm not knocking electronica.
Yeah,
but
so much of it is based off of how it was mastered and how it was mixed. Yeah. You know, that is a lot. And there are contemporary artists who really care about that. So, I mean,
the album that will blow your mind is Random Access Memories with Daft Punk. That album with this technology.
Really? Okay.
Oh my, it is ridiculous.
Well, because I was thinking it was really, it almost feels like pre-digital era is going to work best.
Mm-hmm.
So you could sort of, on one side of the line, you could put Led Zeppelin, Beatles, Merle Haggard, right? And the other
I
side, it could be.
I wouldn't necessarily put them in the same.
But I mean, and then the other side that would make it tougher is, you know, more modern artists like Justin Bieber would not be great on this, I think, because it's just, there's
but
just so much processing.
Set, an acoustic set, actually. Or a live performance.
I was going to get the Justin Bieber haters.
Yeah. Wow. How could you, man? How could you?
Yeah, you're dissing the Biebs, dude.
Yeah, I know.
The Biebers are coming for you, man.
You know, I got to say.
We're getting doxxed right now.
No, this guy. As much as everybody hates Justin Bieber, a lot of, you know, people, the guy is an artist.
Oh, yeah.
He reinvents himself. But he reinvents himself. He's like Madonna. He reinvents himself. He changes sound. He's not going to go away. He's going to be here for the rest of our lives. And I really think, you know.
Yeah.
He's maturing.
Yes.
You know, so.
Oh, everybody does.
But so we still have so many questions piling in. I'm sorry. I need to get to these. E-Lopez is asking, why doesn't the dongle version you are holding not compatible with iPhones?
It is not yet, and that's mostly because of the lovely walled garden that Apple has. It takes a lot what we're doing requires some, you know, we need access to make sure that we can do it. That's why it's easy for us to do on the PC and the Android side, because the audio streams are a lot more open in those platforms and we need as much information as possible. However, we do have other versions of this tech. So this is just the first step. You know, there's a reason why SuperXFi is kind of in its own chamber of creative, and that's because we're planning on, you know, licensing this tech to companies that want to use it. Creative and Sound Blaster obviously are going to be some of the first products that are first to market with it, because we're from the parent company that makes it. But you know, we have a headphone that's coming out that's a Bluetooth headphone that's going to have this integrated inside of it. We also have some other products as well that aren't announced, but we'll be announcing at CES. But if you listen to what I said earlier and kind of see where I'm talking from, you'll get an idea of what's going to be coming, but integrated into the actual product. So the headphone version will work seamlessly with iPhone, no problem. And you can get it to work with iPhone. You just have to have an adapter and you have to, you know, go through the hoops that the walled garden kind of locks you away
right.
from.
So if you set it up on an Android phone and then you plug it into Lightning to a USB-C, it would work because it's already set up. Yeah.
So two more questions around that. What is it officially compatible with?
PC and Android. So PC and Android are your most compelling offerings. It will work with Apple. We just can't say officially yet because we have to jump through those hoops. But you saw it when they were at the demo. It does work. It works flawlessly. Once this thing is programmed, you don't need to do anything else. It's got your profile stored inside of it. It's not using drivers from the system. It's its own self-contained device.
Yeah, it's a USB audio class.
USB audio class, yeah. That's it.
Also, we don't have to spend too much time, but it does work on two consoles, the PS4 and the Switch. How come not the Xbox?
Same story. You know, Xbox, you got to pay the Microsoft tax to access USB audio. They're not open platform like Sony.
Yeah. The USB audio is not open?
You have to pay the authentication to use it. Yeah. You can't. It's the same reason why you can't just go plug a USB headset into an Xbox. You have to get an officially licensed Xbox headset, you know, from one of the guys that pays the toll.
Yikes.
Sure. So,
that's clever.
And you know, and it's just the way Microsoft has chosen to go the route, which is odd because PC, they're completely open, but the Xbox, they're not. And they want to merge the two. So they have this wall there, but obviously they're making a lot of money through all the headsets that they're selling to the Xbox fans. But PS4 and Switch are just using USB. And actually, Sony went out of their way. It sounds fantastic on a PS4. I've been playing Red Dead Redemption with this, Red Dead RDR2. Oh my God, man. It is crazy. It's like sitting
there. Don't look at Gordon when you say that. What? Don't look at him. He hates consoles. He hates consoles.
Don't even. Consoles are okay for people who choose to use them or can't afford
them. I have.
There's nothing wrong with
that. We'll talk about my build in a minute. I have a PC. I got my PS4 specifically because there are titles on the PS4 that are definitely worth my time, like God of War and RDR2. RDR2 is awesome. Like it is. And with this, I'm a weird person. But one of my favorite movies is Hateful Eight. I love that movie so much.
Yeah.
And the RDR2 part at the beginning when they're up in the snow, and I'm not going to do spoilers and stuff, but it just reminded me so much of that movie because I felt like I was in this gigantic movie theater. Versus the headphones on my head, because obviously I don't want that stuff being played for my 12-year-old daughter. So.
And I will confirm, Gordon, plug your ears. I've been playing it on PS4 and on Switch and in portable mode, surprisingly. You know,
it's
like,
awesome.
It really is
Diablo
crazy.
Diablo is nuts. Diablo with this is nuts. It's like,
why is that? Why is it amazing on like a little tiny...
So for me...
we're talking about the audio here.
Yeah, audio. The so you plug it in.
He means consoles are amazing.
You're playing Switch with the small window, and to me, it's the only way I can describe it is, I feel like this god that's looking through a little portal in the sky down at this carnage that's happening, and the audio is all out here, but everything is here, but it all works because the audio cues are still here, but everything sounds big.
Yeah, so you feel like you're in the space. Yeah, it's really hard to describe, especially on that one.
It's crazy, but it's the way it works, and I love it just because there's been so few what is it, view changing moments for me in my gaming career, right? Like, you know, the first time that I ran my Orchid Righteous 3D with Tomb Raider and I saw a voodoo, you know, that
that's
was
the
like,
next section,
right? Yeah, 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 yeah. We won't jump there, but this is one of those things for me where I'm like, holy crap, I'm experiencing something new.
Yeah.
And that doesn't happen anymore. No. You know, it's so rare. It doesn't.
What about the really like the haters? Now, I'm because you get this all the time, but the haters are going to say, this is just standard, way too much reverb, standard EQ, and then they just kind of like sell it as something brand new, sprinkle some magic branding on there. Where those people, you got, because you know you're going to run into them. A lot of people are going to say, I don't believe it.
And technically, it is using reverb to kind of delay timing. That's how sound works. So.
HRTS, yeah. Yes, and right, all you know. That. And but in a way that is natural and yeah, not over processed. You know, I've matured in my, I really have, because those haters are a lot, they're like people that are in certain factions of politics.
Yeah.
You can't change their minds through arguing with them. You can't change their minds through logic. You can't change their minds through fact. They have their own set of facts. So what I like to do is, come at me, man. Come at me at a show. Come at me. Listen to the technology. And I'll tell you right now, I've had some phenomenal haters come up to me at BlizzCons, at game, PAX, CSGO events and you know, all these events we've gone to, and I've shown them the tech and they've openly said, okay, I was wrong.
Oh.
And okay. I don't go, yeah, man, I told you so. I'm just like, I get it. I totally get it. That's the thing about audio is the thing I've learned to accept is unless I give you the experience, it's really hard for you to take that leap. And that's why our fans, you know, the people that are Soundblaster fans tend to stay Soundblaster fans because they've experienced it and they love what they get. The people that haven't tend to go over towards the hater camp because they haven't heard it, but once they hear it, they get it, and they jump on the wagon.
Drinking the haterade. Sorry, we still got all these questions coming in. Yes, it does. It does work on Mac.
Yeah.
And then absolutely. Somebody's asking. Rusty's asking, will it give us extra frame rate? like our RGB.
We're doing the audio processing. I don't think it's going to give you extra frame rate.
I
can't make that claim, but I will throw that at our engineers and maybe they can make that claim.
Oh, and I forgot to follow this up with Gary is asking a great question. What are the certified headphones? Because certified headphones, and what happens when you don't? I mean, I know the answer, but
yeah. So the certified headphones are headphones that we've taken and we've tested, because what we're also doing is when we're doing this fine tuning of the way you hear stuff, we want it to get to be as precise as possible. And a lot of times there are certain characteristics of headphones that we can fix with this technology as well. So what we're doing is we go in and we modify the hardware curve on the fly so that it helps with the effect. So we've gone in, we've measured these headphones, we're adjusting some imbalances, we're changing things. We're not changing the characteristic of the way your headphone's going to work, but we're making it work as best as possible with the headphones, with our technology. Hopefully you guys understand what I'm saying. So we're going through and we're adding, you know, we have a series of, you know, of course, creative headphones that we've done. We have a bunch of other ones, really, you know, most of the popular headsets and headphones
AKG, Audio Technica, Beyerdynamic, even the Bose QC35-2, which is like one of the top selling it, but I need to try it on there because I actually don't like the sound of those headphones.
There's a lot of
and you don't buy noise canceling headphones. Yeah.
Yeah.
You usually don't buy noise canceling headphones because of the audio quality. No. But yeah, I mean, for me, it's been because I've tried it on a bunch of different ones, even unsupported ones. And it's you still get the same effect. Mm-hmm. It just depends on the signature of the headphones. You know, it's going to sound better on.
And
on
we're
better
building that
headphones.
Library constantly. Yeah. Right. And we have people submitting their headphones for us to test too.
There will be more. That's just.
Oh, that is, you know, if it's a top selling one, we already have a profile for it. If it's a little more esoteric one, we're getting to those because the idea is to make it work with everything. And there's a generic profile that's going to get you to that 98th, 99th percentile. It's just we're going for perfection.
Yeah.
You know, that's what we're going for with this.
And for people to know, once you're in the app and you say set this headphone up, it basically writes that profile to this, and then you can move it anywhere else.
Yeah, and so, and then when you plug it into the PC, you actually have to manually select that it's a 7.1 source.
Yeah.
So there's no drivers you need to load. Nope. It's just plug and play. You just have to go through and set it to 7.1, which, you know, and there's a lot of people out there who say, hey, you know, I don't like Creative because I don't like the drivers. I've been burnt by the drivers before. This doesn't require any drivers.
No. And that's the beauty of it is, and as we're moving forward, we're moving more and more towards the hardware side where we're relying less on the interface with the OS and more on the hardware side and just saying, hey, we'll take it on the hardware end. You know, right. As we've become more and more integrative with our chips, we're able to do that now. And that doesn't leave us at the mercy of Microsoft or the OS people as well, because we can handle everything in hardware.
And does E. Lopez asking, does this replace the AE-5 or G6 for gaming?
It could. It could right now.
I mean, to tell you the truth, like I would much rather carry this around between, you know, wherever I'm gaming, home, PC, console, or even at work. It's so much easier to just plug this in and have that than a dedicated sound card, in my opinion.
Yeah, no, and you could see where we've gone, like with the G6 and some of the other stuff. You know, we're definitely making portable because people are listening on so many different devices. We want to make it as accessible as possible to those people that have integrated audio into their lives. They're kind of different purposes though. You know, the Super X-Fi in this format is more of a general purpose thing, right? It's not as customizable as an AE-5. It's not going to give you that super fine control, but if you don't want that, then this is the perfect option.
Well, and it doesn't have like gamer specific things like what's that scout mode? Is that what it's called? Yeah. You know, things like that. So, you know,
this particular version,
all that.
At this time.
So we should also say, so right now this is the dongle, but there will be headphones with it built in.
Yep.
Right.
And other products. Yeah. Okay. We'll be showing a lot at CES.
So, I mean, you know, for people who have lived the Sound Blaster, you know, ecosystem for a while, like we've had things like Crystallizer and other, I mean, this sort of builds upon things like Crystallizer and other technologies.
This came from, you know, this is kind of the segue over too. This came from the very beginning. I mean, Mr. Sim talks about this and he's like, this is $100 million investment, you know, R&D. This is the kind of latest format of all of that technology, going back to the EAX days, through the X-Fi days, through through every iteration of our technologies. And then this has been refined and distilled and then hardware centralized into a chip. You know, the chips that are in the AE-5 are the predecessor to the chip that's in the Super X-Fi. So, this is taking everything that we've done and putting it all into one place.
Critique Truth, weird name, asks, did you patent this new tech?
Oh, hell yeah. Nah, it's all open source.
Yeah, open source. Yeah. Open source.
I mean, but I do think, you know, Mr. Sim's vision for this is, you know, he's always had this passion for audio. You know, we've had some just incredibly innovative, you know, products like the Prada keys, right? The keyboard and the keyboard thing together, which was tremendously popular when it was launched, because he's always looking at how can I integrate better audio in people's lives. So, you know, I would not rule out at some point this having that kind of outreach at some level, because we want this to be pervasive and we want people to experience it, because we want people to realize the way you're hearing audio right now doesn't have to be it. We can change that.
Well, and the fact that it's also, you know, it's software based, like you said, if you know somebody with one, you plug it in, it activates it. So you just run it on the phone side.
Yep.
You know, and then I've tried some of it, but it does restrict to loading stuff, through the app. So you can just listen to
and
music
we have
through
to
the
do
app,
that because
which
the
makes
the
sense.
OS works, right?
Yeah. But, I mean, which makes sense.
The convenience of the hardware is you plug it in anything and you're good to go.
Yeah.
You don't got to worry about anything from that point on.
Halstein Jenkins is asking, does this have anything to do with Realtek audio on most boards? And I'll have a follow-up on that. Could this be, you know, built into motherboards?
It can absolutely be built into motherboards. And it doesn't really have anything to do with Realtek. I mean, Realtek's
bypassing it at that point.
Yeah, we completely take over as the audio host at that point. So, you know, Realtek would go into the background and we'd be handling everything in hardware here.
Right. And it would be, in theory, cleaner because Realtek are still chips down on the motherboard and you're moving, you know, clean, pristine digital audio outside.
Yeah.
To your headphones.
But I will say though, it is actually, I mean, though the idea of having it built into a motherboard would be cool, I do personally like the portable nature, and I can do it on my PC and also on my phone, you know, like, so it's, you know, it's a give or take. I guess it just depends on the circumstance.
Yeah. And well, and the cool thing is, if you were on your motherboard, let's just talk about that. If it were on your motherboard, you'd be like, okay, my profile's stored. This stays in my bag all the time. Mm-hmm. And now I don't have to worry about it for my PC. So,
because you do sign in and it is cloud based. So, yeah, you know, I've signed in, I'm switching phones all the time to test, you know, so I have re-downloaded the app, signed in, and everything's there.
Yep. And the beauty of it is every time we get a profile and, you know, we build the database bigger and bigger and bigger, so it becomes more and more accurate. So it's one of those things that, you know, they've really thought this through, and we're stoked to build on it.
And will there be tunability built into the phone app eventually? Sort of like, yeah. I mean, there's just some things where you want to, like, if you're, again, old music is like phenomenal, yep, like life changing kind of thing.
Yep.
And then some of the newer stuff was like, I'd want to dial some of it back a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, right now you can go in and you could change the EQ and you could do things like that, but there certainly is iterations that will be coming that are going to give you a lot more free reign. I think the goal right now is for people to experience it as we intend them to experience it, so right, that we can kind of have that breakthrough aha moment. And then you open it up from that point on and people can just go ballistic with it. I think it's smart to kind of stay on the track and kind of, you know, walk before we run. So, but I'm with you. I like tinkering and playing around with stuff. So,
yeah, I mean, for me, a lot of it, you know, especially when I first brought it home outside of the controlled environment, it was definitely, I did feel my brain fighting against it. You know, you have to just say, hey, listen, you know, you have to retrain yourself when you're wearing headphones to say, okay, just imagine the speakers are not against my head, that they're actually sitting in front of me. And it helps when you have something visual to link onto, like if you're playing a game or watching a movie. Music is a little harder because you're kind of in the nebulous. I mean, unless you're watching it through YouTube, then your eyes still have something to link onto. Another hurdle that I have a hard time getting over sometimes is that knowing, and maybe others might not, but I know the acoustics of the room I'm in. So if the profile doesn't necessarily match that, brain kind of disconnects a little bit, which, you know, hopefully that will, something that would come later is to say, okay, you know, I know I'm in a more echoey room, so I want it to sound, you know, just as echoey as that, or I'm in a really, you know, dampened room, but I'm hearing echo and it's making my head kind of, you know, bend a little bit. So some of those customization features would be nice to come in the future for
and
sure.
I mean, our guys are going to be watching this, so
yeah.
You know, and you, I gotta work. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was just gonna say, you might want to, you know, we'll get that submitted to the thing. What's cool about it is we listen constantly, and that's all we've been doing from the beginning when we were rolling this tech out. And they've even rolled in refinements from the first round of kind of release, and they kept it local, and they really had a very large focus group so that we could take a lot of this info. So I imagine as it gets bigger and bigger and we get more and more feedback, we're just going to refine this thing and keep making it even more amazing than it is. Cause even starting point is just mind blowing.
And tell us, so Mr. Sim, when we were there, he did mention some of this testing in Singapore, like the results. I mean, one of the things that made me a little sad is that, you know, if you're a younger person and you've pretty much only worn headphones and are used to headphone audio, you don't necessarily know how music sounds out of speakers. Yeah. And so, you know, some people were just like, oh, this is weird, you know, like just cause they didn't, which is weird to me, but you know, like it's the truth. You know, some people just like that isolating experience. I also mentioned earlier, you know, my wife, she typically doesn't wear headphones because it feels a little claustrophobic, but when I had her try it out, she was like, oh, this doesn't feel claustrophobic, it doesn't feel like the speakers are right next to my ears, feels like the speakers are out in front of me. And that was a big thing.
I mean, and then that's the interesting stuff is when you, it kind of has brought perspective to me too, because I'm going, oh wow, you know, I never thought of it that way. I hear audio this way, I perceive audio this way, and getting all this information from the focus group and all the testing, it's really interesting to hear. Like, yeah, you know, I guess if I was a 14, 15 year old, I grew up with earbuds in my ears. You know, I never listened. I never had a surround speaker system in my house. I never, you know, you go to the movies and that's the one thing that everybody has experienced, right? Like, so my thing is like, hey, imagine you're in a movie theater, and that's what we're going to simulate. That's what we're going to create for you, is this holography. And that's the aha. Okay, I get it now. But if you try to say like, oh, you know, imagine your 7.1 system in your house, you know, 7.1 speaker systems are like almost non-existent anymore. You know, they don't sell. And, you know, so even gamers, it's become a headphone game for a lot of people. But I also think part of that is because there just hasn't been a compelling reason to have 7.1, you know? Mm-hmm. So, you know, we might get a bounce back effect where people go like, I want speakers now because I hear what it should sound like with this. I want the actual thing. And, you know, you never know. It goes in cycles and waves. But yeah, it's cool to get the information and to realize that everybody's hearing it. So as a challenge, it's up for us to say, yeah, but which one makes you more comfortable? You know, and like you said, with the adjustment period, everybody has kind of a different adjustment period. For me,
definitely.
For me, it was pretty quick because I'm a musician, so I prefer to have that open sound stage. I prefer to be kind of in the environment, and so for me, it was a natural like, oh yeah, this is how it's supposed to be, man. You know, if I'm up on stage, or right in front of, you know, Geddy Lee, and I'm listening to YYZ, it's pretty freaking epic, man. I'll tell you that right now, dude.
For younger people, Geddy Lee,
Rush.
Was in a band called Rush from Canada.
I'm dating myself, but yeah.
I got to say the first time it really hit home for me when I brought it home was when I was playing. I fired up Destiny. Yeah. I was still trying to slog through some of that stuff, and I was doing I can't remember what it was called. It's one of the newer pieces of content. Anywhere where you have to go over and kind of hold a control point.
Yep.
And the control point is this like some sort of orb thing.
Yeah.
That's kind of like
hovering.
Hovering 10 or 12 feet above you. You know. And at first I was kind of on the periphery of it. You know, clearing the guys. And when I kind of backed up under where the orb was, I literally heard it and felt
you could
it.
Feel
you know
it
what I mean?
You.
Like I was just like, okay, like it doesn't just have, you know, it has the two axes,
the height.
That's the beauty
on the PC side and getting those extra streams is we take all of those streams, and the more you feed this chip, the more audio info you feed this chip, the more impressive it becomes. So, you know, we were talking about Android, and you know, there's some phones that are doing multi-stream audio with Android, and we're hoping that becomes more and more prevalent. And even on the Apple side, we're hoping, because as content is being developed and as content comes out and this type of technology becomes micronized and available to, you know, you're on a plane for 8 hours and you feel like you're in a movie theater versus a closed tube hurtling through the air at, you know, God knows how fast. It relaxes you. You know, fatigue is lower. Mm-hmm. You feel like you're not as compressed inside. You feel like you're sitting in a room. So your body kind of, you know, adjust to that.
You know, that'd be interesting. I definitely want to try that on a plane because, you know, you don't even watch your tablet anymore. It's all the in-air entertainment.
Yep.
I want to plug it into the, you know, the analog out and see.
Yeah. And, you know, Mr. Sim had a custom adapter made for him because he flies Singapore Airlines. Yeah. And he has the actual click done. You know, it's good to be the king, I think.
I just want to mention because I was doing some positional testing and I tried some of the older tools like Rightmark, you know, 3D audio test. Yep. And I found it didn't, like, I wonder if like the old positional tools aren't as effective because what I also did is I fired up a Blu-ray.
Mm-hmm.
You know, on a PC, right?
Yep.
That's like, what? Who does that anymore? But I fired up a Blu-ray, you know, set it to 7.1 and I did it and watched Avatar. And there were definitely some parts where they're flying through the waterfalls.
Yes.
And really, it's just one of those things like, it just kind of like you
feel it swoosh.
You feel
across.
You're flying past the waterfalls and the positional is excellent.
Yes.
I mean, like, excellent.
Yep.
So,
and that's the cinematic difference versus that's the reason why we call it the headphone holography versus the virtual surround, because the way that virtual surround is tuned, I feel is almost to be incredibly abrupt. You know, so it's like, if I'm a gamer, I want a clear what's the best way to describe it? If you're playing a game and you're using positional audio, it's not the way that typical positional audio works, it's very limited in where it can put things because there's only a certain amount of places it can put stuff. One of the advantages that we've had on the Sound Blaster side is we create sub channels on the fly because we have a processor that is able to go, wait a minute, it's not at 0.7, it's at 0.7.4, right? Versus from 7 to 8. Hmm. And our chip can do that in real time and position it versus a codec that's just saying, okay, I got to spit this out to channel 7. I got channel 8. So you have these abrupt leaps that happen. And I think what you're experiencing with the tools is that those tools are meant to be measuring against that standard versus this kind of refined standard. Yeah. So they don't stack up as well. But if you're listening to a movie where they're doing a really, really subtle sound design pan from this channel's crossfading out to the next channel, we see that and our chip goes, oh, I get what you're doing. And it does that for you on the fly and feathers it even more so that that effect becomes more pronounced.
Right.
So it all comes
just less coarse. I mean, yeah, a lot of ways.
And,
just,
you know,
with
PC
more
audio, pretty lazy sound design by a lot of developers. Well, I mean, I'm not going to lie. I'll put them on blast. There are some absolutely, I'll throw a shout out, man. The guys at Rockstar, the guys at Blizzard, and gals, you know, everything's equal because there are some phenomenal female audio designers, which is so cool to see happening in the industry, especially with my 12-year-old daughter following them. Like, that's what I want to do. Those teams that pay attention to sound, they're the ones that are dropping hit games. Like they're the, and people don't realize just how important sound is. You know, a game is kind of substandard when the audio is just kind of eh.
Yeah.
You know, it really comes down to sound design, you know, and we're going to make great sound design sound amazing.
Right. And to be fair, it's always audio is the audio budget is always what?
Oh, it's
4% of the entire game. If you're lucky.
I mean, most of the time you have, you know, I don't want to diss all the sound guys, but I've talked to a lot of people and they're like, oh yeah, you know, I started in the sound department.
Sounds always an afterthought.
Intern. Yeah. You know, and there's a lot of
the last line, the last thing that gets done.
Yeah. So I always appreciate, you know, as a sound guy, and I believe me, I have to listen to all these games. Whenever something comes through and I'm like, oh man, that's so awesome. You know, it's just refreshing when you get that. You could tell there's some craftsperson stuff. There's somebody crafting this versus just throwing it through a reverb filter or whatever it is, you know? Yeah.
So, yeah, let's, it's so hard because there's so much to it, you know, it's like there's caveats to say, hey, well, you know, it depends on the kind, like a lot of it really depends on the content, you know, some content, if it's bad sound design in a game or if it's a music that has, you know, really compressed mastering, like, yeah, you're not necessarily going to get a ton, but in those times where it perfectly lines up and you have a really nice pair of headphones, it's just oh man, you know. Yeah, and I'll save it for later. But I have my own quote.
Nice.
Quotes. Yeah. But yeah, it really is. Yeah,
it's the real deal. And we're not just sticking with this. We are refining it, and we're listening. We're stoked about this. We can't wait to show it to the general population at CES, and then the other flavors and some of the surprises we have using this tech. I think people are going to be like, oh wow.
Well, speaking of surprises,
you want to do a surprise
now?
A
surprise.
Are we already there?
Why don't we do that?
Okay, so
let's.
Well, I wasn't expecting this, so I didn't make like a special.
It's going to be a Creative Labs video card with ray tracing.
Oh yeah, that's
it. RT. I knew it.
No, actually, so we've had a ton of questions ever since we launched the AE-5, and we didn't replace our high end card. We did not replace the ZXR. So I have brought with me what is the, and this is, I've been testing this. I had to take it out of my build because that's why there's that gaping hole in my build. This is the AE-9.
What?
Nine?
So it's four better.
So this is the Sound Blaster, Sound Blaster AE-9. So Gordon, you can hold that. And
holy smokes.
Wait, does it have RGB?
It does not have RGB.
What, dude? That's it.
Oh, no, it does.
Dude, oh, it does. Oh, okay.
This thing has a 6-pin power plug.
So the reason, hold on. So we have replaceable op amps, which is something that people really, really wanted. Uh-huh. The reason why it has a 6-pin op amp is because we have brought back the breakout.
Oh, nice.
And we have a breakout that actually has phantom power. So you can plug in your XLR microphone. We have a this volume. Our volume knob actually controls the system volume. We have a customized cable that's going to go from the back and interface with this here, with the back of your card. We have a quarter inch headphone port, which is something people have asked for a lot, especially with these high end cards. This has our X-Amp technology, so it powers the bi-amplified headphones. So we're actually pushing quite a bit of power to this because we know we're kind of in that space going up against some of the dedicated DAC amp, external ones. Right. So this is our answer to it. We have all the audio processing over here. We've separated the DAC from the Soundcore 3D. So when you're in direct mode, you never even touch the DAC at all, or when you're in direct mode, you never even touch the Soundcore chip, so it's on its own path now.
Okay. So the DACs are external then. So they're in the box.
Yeah, they're right here. So this is these are the op amps.
Okay.
So the op amps are there. The DACs are their own component. They're inside here. The Soundcore is here as well, and we've separated the two away from each other. So one of the things we used to do was we used to route. With the AE-5, everything was being handled by the Soundcore, and then we had awesome, op amps, and we had our awesome, output. But with this level of a card, with the audiophile level of a card, we've separated everything else into their own paths.
People seem to be liking this. A couple quick questions. Yep. David,
and no RGB.
Yeah, it's got illumination, but it's not RGB.
Jeez. David is asking, can I water cool it?
That's a guy, I will be. I gotta get with the guys. I'm an EK fan, so I gotta get with the guys at EK. We gotta do something. I mean, you'll see in my build if you show that picture. I've flushed everything out with EK stuff, but you could water cool it. I don't think you're gonna necessarily need to, but
like water cooling RAM people.
If you're doing a lot of Battlefield 5, you're gonna be pushing this thing pretty hard.
So this is
A couple more questions.
Nobody's seen this. This is like, I literally have not even
world
seen this.
World reveal.
Yeah, this is the world
Sound
reveal.
Blaster.
This is the first time we're showing this in public.
That's awesome. Thank
you. I'd only seen renderings of this box. I haven't even seen renderings. I haven't even seen the physical breakout until I didn't even open it before I came here. So I was hoping it would look good. We haven't peeled the plastic.
and you're not using USB power because you need substantially more.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So,
For the bi amplification. And to power this the way we want to power it. Yeah.
Got it. And Eric is asking, better support compared to the Z series?
Okay. So that's like one of those trick questions. Right? So yeah.
Where did you stop beating your system?
No. It's cool. We actually, this is one of those things that I strive and I'm striving hardest to break, and that's we don't listen to the population, and we kind of make bad drivers and whatever. I've opened up a subreddit on Reddit. I have a subreddit that I go in and I talk to and I converse with people. We've already resolved a ton of things. We get feedback all the time, so we're completely open. So yeah, I will say better support than the Z, because we've been supporting the Z. We're going to keep supporting this. There is no doubt that our goal is to make it effortless and seamless for people. It's something we strive for. Unfortunately, when you're dealing with Windows, yeah, there's always going to be some, hardware
somewhere.
Issues and whatnot, but we absolutely
It's a
big tent. And it's not knocking anybody, but we work our butts off to make sure that we work with as many people as possible. I mean, we had a weird thing with the G6 when we first launched it. A couple of people found some issues with 32-bit audio, and within 3 days, we got the reports. We talked to the people on the subreddit. We got some stuff back from them. We fixed it within a week. So we're listening. And you can be assured this is our flagship baby.
World exclusive.
Yeah, world exclusive, man. Nobody else has seen this.
Terry's asking, does it come with a 6-pin Molex?
Yes, that's what's in the back here. No, not the 6-pin, not the old school. This is actually your
GPU power.
PCIe connector.
Holy smokes. That's like,
also
45, 55 watts. I forget.
Yeah. We're cranking some power through this bad boy.
45 volt phantom power.
Yes. 45 volt phantom power. You have a TRS and an XLR connection here on the front. You got your 3.5 millimeter jacks. You got a quarter inch jack. You have your high and low gain here. The DBSNR on this is 129. So it is, it is, you're not going to get any better.
Yeah,
that, it's just that simple. We are using the super high end Saber class DAC on this. This is a beast. I mean, you're in my rig that I built, I wanted for the first time in my life, the best of the best. And so it was kind of cool to have, I mean, you know, we're going to get the AMD people in here, but, you know, I have the RTX 2080 Ti, which is also a subject for debate, but we got a driver improvement this week. We got 50% improvement, and I can cross my fingers and hope that that's going to work. You know, I got a 9900K, and then I had this in there. So it's like, I've striven for this my entire adult life to like, okay, I have what could arguably be the top of the top right now for, you know, it, without going in debt and,
right.
Nice.
And ruining my daughter's college fund.
But before we get to your awesome build,
yeah, no, I don't want to divert.
MSRP.
$299.
Oh, nice.
Availability?
Nice. It will be shipping. I actually think in 3 weeks. So wow. It's going to ship before the end of December is what we're gunning for.
But not for just sort of typical gamers. This is aimed at obviously audiophile
musicians. This is aimed at
musicians.
If you want the best of the best. So it is going to rock for gaming 100%. But if you're a streamer, you got your integration here with the microphone. You can get rid of that mixer on your desk. It has a new driver interface that we've made specifically for this card. And we're actually looking at it to modify some of our existing cards as well. It's called Sound Blaster Command. And the reason why we're putting it out into the Sound Blaster brand is we know that there is a sizable subset of people that are audiophiles on the PC. This is the audiophile's dream PC card. Replaceable op amps. You have your breakout. You have bi-amplification. I mean, 129 dB. It's ridiculous. I've been listening to this. I never thought, you know, AE-5 was kind of cream of the crop, and there's a noticeable difference with this even from the AE-5. So I'm excited.
And $299 is for the whole thing.
Whole thing, yeah. Comes as a kit, so it's all one big happy family.
Got it.
So it'll be coming out. These are like the pre-production. This is the first line samples, but we're testing everything out and putting it through QC right now. So as long as everything holds to the schedule and everything looks good right now, we'll be good to go.
And Rusty's asking, would you need a preamp to go with that particular deck?
No.
Cool. Awesome.
No, you're good to go.
Wow.
So yeah. Cool. So this is it. First time anybody's seen it. I'm digging it. We've put a lot of time and effort. There's a little, you know, satisfying glowing ring here as well, which is really nice.
RGB.
Yeah, no.
Is it, at this point, is it you're pretty much going up against all those super expensive external?
Yeah. We're offering what they offer plus a lot more. And we know it's a tough space. And of course, you have the loyalists and stuff. But I think when we start getting head to head, people are going to see the difference because you can have the direct experience, the direct audiophile experience, no interference with processing. But if you want to go into a game and you want to have things that, you know, make gaming cool, you pop it over there and you have the best of both worlds.
Right. I mean, that is the weakness of those external audio is gaming is not.
Yeah, you're relying right? on software at that point. Yeah. So, you know, and we do things now in our software suite where we can enhance if you're using different surround technologies, if you're using something like a Dolby Atmos or whatever it is, we actually can recognize that and we will enhance that versus over, you know, technology plus technology.
Is there Dolby Atmos on? Sorry, Adam, I just got to ask. Is Dolby Atmos making inroads on the PC? I know there's a plugin in the store, but
it's in some game engines by default. Yeah, so like Overwatch has it built in and those type of things.
So I'm confused because isn't that just DirectX 3D? I mean, DirectSound 3D. I mean, so for people who don't know, Atmos is, you know, instead of just simply mixing it and then sending it to a spot, it's actually sending, right? It's actually singing positional audio, and then the Dolby Atmos takes over and
the software layer takes over and does the work.
Place the sound over here, which is like, that's what we used to do in 1999, right? Yeah. So I don't understand.
Probably before that, actually.
Yeah. I mean, way back when. But so I don't understand what in the hell. Why don't we just go back to the, well.
Yeah, and that's. You know, that's the people don't understand how audio works. It's our job as the company that sells audio products to get people to understand. So you're going to see a lot from us over the next few months.
David is asking, does this support Super XFi?
I am not.
He's not saying.
And P Dub is asking, can I get a can I pair the AE-9 with the Super X-Fi for Super AE-5?
I love it. I'm gonna trademark that.
Super AE-5.
Super AE-5. Yeah. So this is it.
Nice.
So we've had a lot of requests, like, when are you guys replacing the ZXR? When am I gonna actually be able to upgrade from my, you know, X-Fi Titanium? And we knew with those cards we had a very, very big
loyal audience.
And we had to come up with something that was going to be worth it for them. So this is actually just a phenomenal piece of
hardware. Nice. I'd love to check it out.
Yep.
But you said you took it out of your rig at home, right?
Which we
keep alluding to, but you made a new rig at home. Why don't you tell the people all about it? And I actually have a nice photo to flash up.
Yeah, let's see the picture.
So it's not super clean. I'm working. I still have a lot to do in wiring format, but it's my Peace Amongst Worlds build. It has the Rick in there, and he's given the Peace Amongst Worlds.
Yeah, you symbol. Can kind of see him right by the RAM.
So what I did was this all started with the RTX. So NVIDIA, in their masterful, presentation, me as a marketing guy fell for the marketing.
And I got to start somewhere.
And I was sitting there and I'm like, you know what? I've always waited until after launch. I've always been, I said, I'm going to go for it this time. I'm going to go and I'm going to pre-order the best of the best. So I get the RTX and I put it in. It comes, some weird pre-order fiasco stuff. I pre-ordered on NVIDIA. Then I went to EVGA and then I decided I want to go with the EVGA because I like their warranty and all that stuff. But I also had to wait for the water cooling block from EK. So I got this thing, and it's the first time ever where I never even plugged the video card into my PC to see if it worked. Because when you go liquid, you kind of take this leap of faith. So I literally got the RTX out of the box and disassembled it and put a water block on it and hadn't even plugged it into my computer. So the whole time I'm like, oh my God, I hope I did not destroy this card in this process. And I've done it a few times now, so I'm comfortable with it. Plug it in, get it going, get the loop. Loop looks great. And it's on my old rig. I had a 6700K, which is perfectly viable. Awesome. That thing. And I delitted it. I told you the last time I was here.
Yeah.
Delitted that and did all that stuff. And that was the most terrifying thing I think I've ever done to my PC. But I was like, I'm going to do this. Then I, start reading on the forums and stuff. Oh, there's a bottleneck. If you have 6700K, there's a bottleneck. So I'm like sleeping and I'm like, oh my God, I got a bottleneck. I got to get rid of this bottleneck. So, it's haunting me. So I go, okay, bottleneck, man. I'm not getting the most out of my RTX card because I have this stupid bottleneck. And of course, I'm looking for ways to justify to spend a stupid amount of money on PC. So I go, my daughter really needs a new PC. So what I did was I came full circle. I was telling Adam this before we went on air. When I was young, at eighth grade, my dad bought, me a new PC for my eighth grade graduation.
Wow.
And I thought it was the coolest. Oh my God, dad bought me a new PC. This is so crazy. It was like a 386 SS16.
I know,
right?
Where this is heading.
Yeah. And it wasn't until like 4 years later that my dad's like, oh yeah, that was my old PC. And I bought some, some awesome 386 DX something or whatever, right? And I got the hand-me-down. And I was a little... I mean, it was cool at the time because I didn't know that, but I was a little like this. You had to do a lot of tinkering to get a 386 SX16 to do pretty much anything. You had a mem maker and all that nightmare. But I made it work, and it actually cut my teeth on figuring out how PC hardware works. But
that was the best part of that. Yeah.
It was the best part. I missed that. The craftsmanship, right? So I go down this path of I have this bottleneck. And so I start looking at the 8700, and then I'm reading the forums and people are saying, it's not that big of a difference if you have a 6700 that's liquid cooled. And I'm like, okay, forget it. I'm dropping this. I'm not going to upgrade. I'm waiting for the next stuff to come out. Then I have the AMD camp people that are my buddies. They're like, dude, Threadripper. And I told you guys, I had a horrible experience with AMD so many years ago. I feel like one of those people that don't like Creative.
Yeah.
And I'm just not budging.
No, you understand.
And I understand. That's why the empathy is coming out, because I'm like, I had a bad experience and they've come a long way. And I'm like, no, man, that bulldozer, dude. that thing was no sledgehammer. It was a six core. What was the six core?
Yeah,
one?
You were telling me it was your it was the sledgehammer.
Sledgehammer,
I think, right?
Yeah, and it was the hottest PC I've ever had. Yeah. It completely would trip out all the time. It just didn't work with any. It was the worst PC I ever owned, next to my Cyrix. I had a Cyrix processor. I was one of the 12 people that bought a Cyrix processor. So this one was just heinous, and I said, "No, I'm never straying from Intel again." Right, and I know AMD fans, they've come a long way. I got people just hammering on me like, dude. And I'm like, okay. And I actually was starting to look at Threadripper builds. Along comes Intel with this 9900K, i9-9900K, 5 gigahertz turbo. And I'm like, oh, no bottleneck. I'm not going to have a bottleneck. There's no bottleneck. I can go to this chip and there's going to be no bottleneck. So I go down that path. And of course, ASUS has an awesome motherboard with the little screen, you know, the little OLED.
Yeah.
It's just sick. I mean, so I have to get that and I'm waiting for that. So I go down this rabbit hole. And the whole time I'm justifying the rabbit hole because, mom, my daughter needs a new PC. The 6700K is going to kick butt for her, man. She can play Overwatch and everything she wants to do with this. It's going to kick butt.
I mean, I think that's what I'm on.
Yeah.
Right?
I mean, it's a sick 1080 Ti. It's a perfectly serviceable high-end rig. But I'm just going down the rabbit hole. And I convinced myself and I'm like, my God, I've become my dad. I've come full circle and I've pulled this off, you know. Meanwhile, my daughter's like, Dad, where's my PC?
Did you say it was brand new, though? Oh, my God.
No, she knows it's not because she's seen that case a million times. She's like, Dad, that's your old PC, man. Like, I'm like, but it's an SSD and it's 600K.
You got to give her the story, though, because you're like, this is how it's done.
Full disclosure, she now knows the circle of life when it comes to PC. So I put this thing together. You know, I got the EK water blocks. I liked the formula board from ASUS because I wanted to do the VRM. I wanted to liquid cool the VRM because I hadn't done that before. And, you know, put it together and it's a beast. And then, so, you know, the thing is just a solid beast.
The two RADs? What? How big is a RAD?
What?
The radiators.
That's a three.
Okay.
Three. Yeah. So I got a Fantex case so I could fit the rad, the three, it's a three slot rad on the top. So I got three fans powering that bad boy. Only one fan on the back. I had to do some modification cause I couldn't find a good place for the reservoir.
But you're water cooling the VRM, so you don't have to worry about that.
Don't got
to
worry about anything. I mean, it's running at five. So I got it 41% overclock. So it's running at 5 gigahertz on its own without any step up, and it's about 38 Celsius.
Dang. Yeah, custom water loops.
I mean,
no
and
joke.
Under load, it goes to about 43. So,
dang.
You know, I'm like, this is pretty sick.
Yeah,
but you feel the heat waving off of it. You know, right now it's pretty cool because it's heating my room. Yeah, but it's definitely, I mean, I'm like, wow, you know, and that's what made me a believer of the liquid cooling is. Just seeing those temps go, like if I go above 50, I start freaking out. And, you know, I'm like, oh, 50, what the hell's going on? But, you know, you can, I think the temp for that's 90, I think is what they say the cutoff is. And for the RTX, it's 92.
Yeah, I think 99. You get up to about 99.
So I'm extending the life of these things. That's my rationalization for spending an exorbiant amount of money.
Well, you're extending the life so you can give that next one to your daughter.
Yeah.
Right? You know?
See,
it's for her.
You have the technique, man. That's what it's all about.
And those I'm like,
see this, you see this awesome rig? Miria, this is going to be yours in 3 years.
Yeah,
the cool thing is when she hands her computers down to her kids.
Exactly. Like, and, you know, the way we're going now.
Mom, can I get a new one?
Yeah.
No, this is the way it's done.
This is your grandpa's computer and you'll like it.
And he talked about it on The Full Nerd.
Yes, he did. We
so
have proof.
Are you happy? I mean, RTX.
I am. I don't have any complaints. I would love, I'm not one of those, I because I know how hardware works, my expectations for RTX were low, ray tracing were low. I didn't have, I know how marketing works because I'm a marketeer, but I was like, you know what? I want to be on this curve. I want to experience this stuff. Even if it's not playable for me, I want to be able, you know, at 60 frames per second, I want to see the difference so I can say, yeah, I was there at the early days of it.
Yeah.
Because again, I'm so hungry for new stuff. Like nothing is new anymore. You know, there's none of this magical
That's why I think people are just, the attitude I hear on ray tracing and the hate over ray tracing is like, NVIDIA should have just waited. Like, nobody just, to release it, like, nobody just simply drops something that's 95% done and you live in the new world. Getting to the new world, There's like scurvy.
Yeah.
There's like people you throw overboard.
Yeah, you know.
It is not an easy deal getting to the new world. There's food with weevils in it.
And sometimes
it's just
maybe
terrible.
Sometimes you just don't make it.
Sometimes you don't make it to that new world.
Yeah. Nope.
Ray tracing is clearly the new world.
Yeah.
And sometimes
I don't know if we're going to get there, but I like the fact that we're at least trying something different.
I mean, we're seeing a few months after release, they're already got a driver improvement with Battlefield. Let's see what they delayed the patch, so I wasn't able to test it, but they're already claiming a 50% improvement. So, you know, maybe we get to a point where it's there. We don't know yet, but I get the hate for it because it was sold with such authority that people that, you know, buy into it. I went into it with the mindset of I'm a marketeer. I don't like to go so hyperbolic with our marketing. I don't like to overpromise. I like to underpromise and then overdeliver. That's why it's so weird talking about Super X-Fi is because it sounds like I'm overpromising, but I'm actually kind of underselling it, in my opinion.
Well, here, real quick, here's my quote. Super X-Fi is way cooler than ray tracing. Well, you can put that on the box.
I love it.
No, but really,
it's better than ray tracing.
But you know what? I got to say, if you actually buy Super X-Fi and you get the right content, you'll just be flattened by how awesome it is.
Yeah.
It is very tough with any current games, probably any games for the next 12 months where you'll be like blown away with the ray tracing.
Yeah.
So for the first time ever, your job is actually easier marketing audio than it is for NVIDIA to market ray tracing. Because it's not easy. It is not easy right now.
Well, and the ray tracing stumbled out of the blocks. You know, they overpromised. And
we saw the Star Wars demo, and I mean everybody knew that they were gonna say you can run the Star Wars demo on this card.
Yeah.
And they did it. They were running the Star Wars demo. It looks incredible, right? Yep. But there's a world of difference between a hand custom coded demo
in real time.
What's actually in the real world.
Yeah.
It's going to take a long time, but clearly you can do that demo on an RTX card.
Yeah.
It's just going to take a hell of a long time to get there.
Yeah. So. It's going to take a very long time to get there.
In the meantime, Ryan says buy Super X-Fi instead.
Save your money. It is, you know, $150 versus $1,000, you know, for the top end.
But you know, not to burst your bubble, Ryan, sorry, you don't got the best card out there anymore. You gotta get an RTX Titan for your daughter.
Oh.
I know your daughter's going to go up and be like, Dad.
My daughter does need ray tracing in her life.
Yeah.
So maybe.
Dad, you didn't give me the Titan. You didn't give me the
best. Everybody angry about that Titan thing? I actually like that. Is so NVIDIA. That is just like so NVIDIA.
So here's what I love.
It's like, go ahead with all your hate.
I love when people go for it, man. In this day and age, it is so hard to NVIDIA's obviously making loads of money and they can do these type of things. But I love when people just go ballistically crazy over the top. It's like a supercar, right? There's no reason for them to exist, but there are people that want them. And, you know, you see the person that has them and you're like, oh, cool, man. Like, you know, I would not drop $2,500 for a graphics card.
Yeah.
Period. But if you do and you got that cash, I'd like to see it run.
More power to you.
I'd like to sit in it for a little. I mean, you know, like the supercar. I'd like to ride in it, but I don't have any aspirations of owning it.
Wait, so you don't want your daughter to have the best? Is that what you're saying?
She got to grow up in the real world, man. Like, you know, I had to scrap growing up. I didn't get stuff handed to me. So, you know, I came from just south of Oakland, man. So for
there
me,
go.
You know, growing up, it was, you know, she's got to have a little bit. She's got a good right now, you know, and she appreciates it. That's what matters.
Oh, yeah. That's a nice machine. What's the graphic card she's running?
She's 1080 Ti.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, she's driving around a Beamer, man. You don't need a supercar.
1080 Ti and a 6700.
That was like my joke, you know, growing up. My very first car was like this 80 something Dodge Omni, man. It was like rusted out and I broke it in like 3 months. The engine bracket broke and it literally fell out of my car while I was driving my girlfriend around, right? And I was just like, what's more embarrassing than your engine falling out of your car when you're driving with your girlfriend?
That's like a commercial.
Not
on
much.
TV. That's like a
I'll
commercial
tell you right now, not much. It was like boom, sparks on the ground. What's happening? I don't know. So
her
know,
friends heard about that one. I think.
Believe me. Yeah, that's another show entirely. Probably for another publication too. But
Yeah.
There you go.
Speaking of old hoopties, do we need to go to the next topic?
You know, we're already in it.
Or do we have like a ton?
We are. I mean, we're an hour 20 minutes, oh so we don't have a ton of time left. Okay. But you know, we should talk about old school.
Yeah. We should talk about old school stuff.
Yeah.
Well,
we had somebody earlier. Oh man, I don't know if I can find it. They said that they got. Here we go. Lucas says. Crap. Anyway, they had started PC gaming with the 8800 to play Crysis. That was their tipping point into PC gaming.
Oh man,
Now you know what I gotta say, because everybody is just so harsh today, and I guess that's good because everybody is used to you get in a car. All the power windows work. The air conditioning works. Yep. And it's an Econobox.
Yep.
Back in our day, an Econobox, manual windows, no air conditioning, POS rattled. It was just like...
The window handle came off.
That's just like how...
A screwdriver or a pair of pliers and you're using it to roll up and down your window.
Airbag. Yeah. I don't even know what an airbag is.
No.
But that's the way it was with the PC before. Yeah, and I think... Here's my question. Are people spoiled today?
Yes.
Because it's just so good. Everything.
You can get anything you want. I mean, Gordon, back in the day, man... you know, I remember getting Computer Shopper or wherever it was, scouring through the ads. Oh my God, they have this motherboard. And then I had to go to some shady backlot, you know, tech park roll up door.
Yeah, it's always the roll up door.
I'd be like, is this it? This is the address. And this roll up door would come up, and there'd be some old dude sitting there like, what do you need? I'm here for the 486 DX Blue Thunder motherboard, you know, but I,
hold on. I got one.
Door goes down. You hear some rustling, you know, some muttering on the other side of the door. Door opens up. There's nobody there. There's just a dude. Here you go. Boom. Cash. You know,
It's always better when it's
all cash. You see one person and he comes out and he's kind of looking around. You're like, what is going on? You know, the only thing I was missing was, are you a cop? You know, like that was the only line. But that was what, and I'm not exaggerating, man. I used to drive and like ride my bike around to these, and they would never be in the same place. You're like, oh, I went to this place last. Wait, that's not the same address.
Yeah.
You know,
compared to today.
Compared to today, you go on Amazon, but you're one click away. You go, yeah,
it shows like, up at your office. You somebody carries it to you.
This was like, you had to find this stuff, and then you had to get there quick. You know, if there was memory modules coming in or process, there'd be a line of like five or six people. And you're like, oh, my God, how many did they get? And if you were lying, if they got five processors, you were sixth in line.
You didn't get it.
You didn't get it. Man. Yep.
And it's not like it's on back order. I'll just send it to me when it's in stock.
Yeah. I mean, I remember going to my friend's house and his dad was like, I don't know what he was doing, but he had trays and trays of memory. Just, you know, like when 1 meg modules were like the thing, right? And I saw all these trays of memory, and it was like, you know, it was kind of like that thing in Scarface where you just have that mound of cocaine. Like, that's what it was to me. I'm looking at this gigantic.
Why did he have all the memory?
Well, he was selling it. Like, he was like brokering it or something. It was like his side business was selling this memory. And I'm just looking at this stuff going, oh my God, look at the value. Like, how much money is that? You know, and I'm like, could I get two of those, please? You know, like, you know, and forking over. I spent money on literally three things in high school, man. I was a round table pizza driver. I spent money on Street Fighter 2. All of my tips went to Street Fighter 2. The manager brought that. I'm convinced the manager brought that system in to take all of the driver's tips back for himself. Because he would empty that thing out at the end of the night. And we would dump all of our tips into playing that. And by the way, I'm probably the world's best Dalsim player on that thing. I was not unbeatable, but he was kind of broken anyway. But anyway, I'm not taking any challenges. I'm sure I'd get my butt kicked. But... that computer parts and car insurance is what I bought, you know, and I had car insurance so I could go to places to buy computer parts. You know, and I'm telling you, man, it was a hobby back then. It was hard. And when you accomplished
back
it
in
and,
my day,
well, yeah,
it and, is and, true though.
And if the stuff worked, like if you got a VLB graphics card to work, you felt like you'd accomplished something.
Right.
It worked, and it probably worked three times.
Yeah, for people who don't know, Visa Local Bus was this basically, we can now call it a half-ass connection because people didn't want to do PCI, which whatever was expensive. So it was a half-ass ISA, and then a Visa connection, Visa connection. And the cards would never, the motherboard's roll is warped.
Yep.
So you could never get the cards a seat right. You would like, you would just put like 400 pounds of insertion force just to get it to go.
Just to get it to go. And then you hope you don't break your board doing it or the card doing it.
And there was no cooling back then. No, that's the crazy thing, right? Nope. There's like, no, none of the cooling. It just ran.
No, the cooling was you tipped the side off and you stuck your house fan up against the side of it, and that was about as cool as you could get it. Everything was
I love AMD, I love Ryzen and Threadripper, great parts, but the first CPU that I ever had bad was a AMD 486 DX, clone, whatever it was. 4650 or whatever, 4100. And it had bad cash on it.
Oh.
But, you know, hey, went back to the store again. Yep. One of those, like, every time you go to the store, they're always eating lunch.
Yes.
Like, I don't know what it is. But back in those days, every time you go in, they'd be eating lunch. They'd look up. I'm not going to stereotype here, but the stores I went to, they'd always be eating Chinese food. Yeah. You go in. He'd like,
I'm not allowed to say those.
I'd say, hey, this chip is bad. And he's like, oh, this is just some dumbass kid, whatever. Yeah. And it would be like, oh, he tested it. It's like, oh, it actually is bad. And they'd swap it out. But I got to work. It was great. It was way cheaper than the Intel part at the time.
Well, and there's moments of terror where you don't know because it's so shady. You don't know if they're going to give you your part back, right? Like, it was always like, am I getting the real deal?
It always felt weird.
And it was just different, man. It was, you know, being able to craft something and that sense of not knowing if it was going to work or not was kind of addictive. It was almost like gambling in a weird way, you know?
Yeah. Or, oh yeah.
But when you got it to work, you were like, yeah, awesome.
I know. I mean, all the builds you do, if you don't get it post 95% of the time on the first throw, then something went wrong.
Something's horribly wrong. You broke a pin or a jumper wasn't, I mean, nobody has to adjust jumpers anymore.
Yeah.
Like, think about that.
I don't even know what that is.
No, on your motherboard, you used to have to go in and change the jumpers and physically look at the board and look at your drive and look and make sure. Now that it's all built into the BIOS, and the BIOS is like, oh, it recognized that we didn't have that. We had to get it right. And then if you didn't post, you're like, oh, crap. And you have to go through jumper by jumper, and half the time they'd have jumper settings on page one of the manual, and then the other half would be on page 19, and you're flipping back and forth. I mean, it was...
Oh, the manuals were worse than cooler manuals.
Oh, God.
Manuals are really good these days, but they are like, they make no sense. Those made no sense.
It was sense. You literally might as well have been reading hieroglyphics and just interpreting, I think this is what they meant. There's a lot of trial and error. I mean, it is definitely easier now. It's so easy that I went into liquid cooling because I wanted to have that experience of building something again and the wonderment of, is this going to work and not leak and destroy all of this equipment? But even liquid cooling is easy now.
Yeah.
Relatively.
Compared to what it used to be.
Yeah.
Now, you know what's interesting? I was talking to, I don't know if you know Bill Owen over at MNPC Tech. He's just a masterclass modder.
Yeah.
And he said the big thing now, and he was just showing off this build. It was a retro build. It looked to me like, I think it was like a P3 733 kind of class. Oh, Dell. Sick, yeah. But it was a Dell classic beige box, and they had like all the bays in there.
Nice.
But it was like all sourced up. They built it and they installed, I think, Windows 98 on there, and it had the cassette tape.
There you go.
Bay adapter. Yeah, and he says they have retro builds or like kind of like,
where it's like muscle cars, right? I mean, the same thing. I always, when people talk about the PC and why am I into PC, you know, my stepfather growing up was really into Mopar and Chevelle and retrofitting this old Chevelle. And so I got to cut my teeth on a lot of, physical, tinkering with cars. Right. And, it's kind of that same vibe, going back in time and going, all right, it's not easy. I gotta assemble this stuff. I gotta take my time. I mean, even the operating systems back then, you had to load drivers. Yeah. Now Windows just is like, I mean, if something doesn't work on a Windows machine now, you probably shouldn't have that in your PC.
Yeah.
Like literally, if it's not, working in some way, shape, or form at boot, there's something fishy about that piece of hardware at this point. So we've gotten to the point where it's pretty risk-free. when you're building your own PC.
Everything was just so hard.
It was really hard, man.
Everything. Like you said, jumpers on your hard drive.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And forget about SCSI, like figuring out SCSI.
Oh, my God.
And,
oh, man. Well, who could afford that anyway?
Well, I know. I had a buddy that was like a, he was like an early Unix guy, and he was, oh, you got to go SCSI. You got to go SCSI. And I'm like, okay, yeah, well, my next build, I'll do SCSI. And I looked at the prices. I'm like, are you kidding me?
Yeah.
Like, what? No, I'm not. That's like the price of my PC.
I think. Yeah, like your fiber channel cable costs more than like my hard drive.
Yes. You know what I came across the other day is I came across a jazz drive. And that really sent me down memory lane, man.
Yeah.
I had jazz drives just full of stuff.
I still have a zip drive.
Zip drives are awesome. The blue one, the killer blue one. Those are sweet, man.
I have one that still works, I think. So.
Wow. That's impressive. Because I don't think mine worked even when it was, you know, relevant. I think it was broke.
I should plug in those. You know what's crazy though? It works. Android still supports floppy and it still supports zip disks.
What?
If you, and I've done this, I'm not making this up. You can plug in a floppy drive into your Android and store data on that.
Holy
floppy
crap,
disk.
That's awesome.
And zip drive. I did it with a zip drive too, just for kicks.
Oh my God, that is nuts. I mean, I guess it's just data, you know?
It's just like that kernel still in the, you know, because it's just Linux, right?
It's all built off of it. That's nuts.
Yeah, so yeah. I guess actually, you know, that would be this. Well, though, even Linux is easy these days.
Yeah.
Remember when it used to be like Linux is like, I mean, my first experience was like, you had to, how do I see the optical drive? Oh, yeah. You got to mount it. Yes. I got to mount the optical drive? Really?
Mount it. I worked for a startup way back in the day called New Fire, and we were making a Vermal VR plugin for like,
oh my God, Vermal's a future, man.
Yeah, I know. We were making a Vermal plugin, and our competitor was like Silicon Graphics or something. And these are a bunch of guys, I think they went off and they spun Rendition. I think they became the founders of Rendition.
Oh, wow.
And I was working in QA with them, and so that was my first experience with Linux and or Unix. I had a Unix box, and it was like learning a completely new language, but I felt so awesome because I'm like, I now know Unix. Like I can use a Solaris box. Like, and that was pretty cool.
Yeah.
Very different.
Just like in Jurassic Park, that scene where she's like, wait, I know this. This is Unix.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. That's kind of like me. I'm like, oh, wow, this is pretty awesome. I felt accomplished. But I miss the sense of wonder is really what I miss. Like, I mean, for me, there's moments in PC history that I miss the sense of wonder when I heard a Sound Blaster. I mean, the reason why I wanted to work for Sound Blaster was Wing Commander and speech pack for Wing Commander and hearing my wingman say, gotcha. And, you know, all right, he's on your six. Like, oh my God, my computer's talking to me, you know, and that was the sense of wonder. And then again, the Orchid Righteous 3D and seeing Lara Croft in, you know, 16 polygons. But with different textures and seeing that, and I'm going, oh my God, I have an arcade machine at home. You know, those senses of wonder, that's what I miss. I miss those milestones that we don't seem to get anymore. And that's why I jumped on the RTX wagon, is I feel like that's the closest to a milestone we get nowadays.
Yeah. And it
VR was supposed to be it.
Yeah. I mean, it's going to get there too for VR, but yeah, I mean, I agree. That's actually a really good rationale. I mean, because there's just nothing.
It's for your daughter.
We're going to get there. As much as all the haters, you know, want to hate, and I understand it. There's nothing wrong with that.
Stop undercutting me.
And you know, I mean, practically, if AMD zigs when NVIDIA zags, then yeah, that'll be great for them. But I still think, you know, ray tracing is going to be the future one day.
Yeah.
This may not be for everybody, but, you know, it is that hard road.
And you
road
have a choice. Like, you still have a choice. You don't have to jump on. And that's the weird thing is, I think, you know, again, this goes back to how we now in society are. We all set up camps now, and it's, you know, one side or the other, AMD, Intel, AMD, NVIDIA, and I'm kind of like the guy that's like, oh, you're cool. All right. I'm going to slide over here. You know, and you're cool. I'll slide over here. I want to encourage people taking bold steps.
Right.
And so for me, it was like, okay, I love my NVIDIA cards. They've been good to me. I like what AMD's doing. I like what they're showing, but they're not showing me anything that's going to give me that sense of wonder.
Right.
And I'm looking forward to and setting my expectations accordingly that when Battlefield gets their patch in and I already updated my drivers, if I'm able to plug that in and pop on RTX and I can play a match, probably, you know, not as smooth as I'd like to, but I get that extra level, I'm going to be like, okay, that was worth it for me.
Yeah. You know, and you're an early adopter.
I'm an early adopter.
You're the person we need to fund the movement, the trip to the new land. Go ahead and set the colony up, lose 65% of the inhabitants.
Yeah.
When it's all ready, we'll come over.
Yeah,
you know,
we'll come over and do it.
Thank you for what you do.
Yeah.
I'm not normally that guy
like that, but this time around I was like, you know what, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna jump in. And the performance of the RTX, aside from ray tracing, is pretty awesome.
Yeah. I mean that's
being able to run at 4K effortlessly, you know, is pretty amazing.
Yeah, you know, I want to ask you, because I mean, obviously we have been doing this a long time, but when did people get so hardened? When everything is just so brittle, you know? Like, it used to be, oh my God, you know, AMD just kicked our ass with the Athlon 64 or FX. It's like, and you had accepted it, right?
I think.
But now it's just like, it's like, I don't know what happened. People just can't.
It's just the way, it's the internet, man.
Like YouTube.
It's YouTube comments. It's YouTube. And no, it is. It's commentary and anonymity. And, you know, I think it's really polarized people into camps where you can go in and just, you take a stance because you want to be controversial and you rub against the grain.
Yeah.
And, you know, and some people are just irrational about that and they love the fight. You know, I mean, it's like when you talk with your friends, when my AMD buddies come over and they're trying to convince me, hey man, Threadripper. I'm like, yeah, but it's okay. Here's my example of the camp thing, right? Hamilton. I'm going to use Hamilton as an example. My daughter, for months, Dad, you got to listen to Hamilton. And she loved it so much. I'm like, I don't want to listen to Hamilton. Like, I immediately turned away from it and said, it's so cool. I don't want to be the guy that likes it.
Oh, I see.
You know what I mean?
I used to do that all the time.
It's kind of like people are like, oh, Pink Floyd. And then you're like, oh God, Pink Floyd. If I hear Pink Floyd one more time. So then on a
Pink Floyd is an early.
Who is that? Neolithic rock group.
Yeah. look it up. It's on the YouTubes and the Wikipedias.
I don't know if it goes that far back.
But on a ride down to LA, I was taking my daughter to BlizzCon, and I'm a musician. I should be in love with this, and I know it's a genius thing. She finally says, "Dad, we got this long car ride. Let's listen to it. Listen to Hamilton. It's one of the best things I've ever heard in my life. It is so ingenious. It is so cleverly written. It is a masterpiece of audio, masterpiece of lyricism." And I'm like, why was I so shut off to this? And it was just because it was so good that I turned away from it because I didn't want to join the pack. And I think that's an instinct we have now, right? Like, we want to recoil from things that the pack is following. And, you know, there's just people that set up camps. And so I took a lesson from that. And I'm like, you know what? I'm not going to be as close-minded anymore. I am going to listen to Dear Evan Hansen. I am going to listen to these other cool things because I don't want to be that guy that's shutting myself off from things.
You know, I have an 11-year-old daughter, so this is like The Greatest Showman.
Yeah, that's another one. Yes.
We were like, oh, we're going to go see The Greatest Showman on the way back from vacation. Yeah. It's like, oh, I got to work. I'm going to go to the Starbucks and I'll meet you guys after the movie. Yep. And they're like, no, you're going. And I loved it. I was really, because the reviews are like, this is one star.
Yeah.
It was a great movie. And my daughter and I enjoy listening to the music from it, which is, you know, I'm like, oh, I'm almost embarrassed to say, but no, actually I'm not. It's an awesome movie.
It's an awesome movie. Inspirational. And so you look at the hardware camps that people set in, and I think people that have bought into these camps feel like they need to defend their tribe.
Yeah.
And that's cool. You can be a fan of it, but I think it also closes you off, you know? So I'll tell you right now, I was one hair's breadth away from saying, okay, I'm passing up this AMD experience I had 10 years ago, this bad experience, and I'm going to go with the Threadripper. And I was looking at water blocks. And then Intel made that announcement, and I'm like, i9, it's too bigger than the 7. Like, you know, and I fell for it, and I went over, and I don't have any regrets. No. But I'll tell you right now, you know, when going to the NVIDIA stuff, the 7-millimeter process stuff comes out, I'm going to be salivating over that stuff because I'm like, oh man, maybe I should have waited for that process, right? So,
yeah, but you know, that's the next time, right? There's always that's
we need the economy to be fueled, man. We should be buying the stuff that is the best, and fueling the economy and going into horrible debt doing it.
The other thing I don't think people you know, like people get really, like they're very possessive of other people's hardware for some reason.
Yeah.
Like Dan built whatever his for a video thing. It's like, those are, that's his money.
Yeah.
You spend your money. If you want to go buy two 2080s and SLI them, because you're just like, you're made of money.
Yeah.
Damn. All I can say is I wish I had that money.
Yep.
It's not what I would do, but still,
well, if
whatever, that's cool. It's more power to you. That's your money. But people, like, they get angry. Like, it's like, dude, it's my money. If you make your money, then you do what you want with your money. Why do you have to dictate what's in my build? And
totally.
I don't understand why that is.
The extent that people go, like, genuine anger is the weird part. Like, no, why did you do that? Like, somehow, you know, Intel came into their house and offended them. Like, you know, just came in the house and peed on the wall or something. Like, why are you so angry about this? Like, there's no reason to be angry, man. I spent my money. If I'm an idiot and this thing sucks, then you can, you have bragging rights all day. But me and you, we're just playing some Battlefield right now, man. We're having fun doing it, and that's
with
all we need to work. Yeah, with, I happen to have ray tracing, and you don't, and, you know. But I don't, see, I don't play that game, though.
Yeah,
you know,
no,
it's just, I'm a geek, man. I love new stuff. I love hardware. I love the little differences. You know, that's why I had to have that little OLED on my motherboard. Because it was,
you know, it's actually very useful.
It is.
It is extremely useful.
I put, so for the first time ever, I put water temperature sensors in my line. So now I know my water in and my water out temperatures. And I'm like,
oh, wow.
That water temperature is getting a little hot. I wonder if I need to add another fan into my, like, I mean, you know, it's geek. I have a plug on either side. I have a sensor on either side. And, you know, I'm finding ways to make it useful other than the fact that it just looks badass. Like, at the end of the day, it just looks badass.
Those temps are really nice, though. That is an impressive.
It's a great thing to have. Yeah.
Especially in a. So, did you delid the 9900K or no?
No, because I heard it was.
Oh, soldered. Right,
they're soldered, but I heard the solder's bad. So I'll wait.
Man,
I don't know if I could justify delid. I mean, the performance I'm getting now with a 41% overclock, and I'm not even. I mean, at load, I'm only hitting 45. Like, I don't need to delid anything.
Yeah,
really. At the end of the day, I'm like,
I could get those extra megahertz.
I don't know if I'm that adventurous, man. Like, because taking apart a liquid block is a pain. You know? Taking apart a liquid build is not. That's the worst part. Is when you switch out a component, you got to drain it and you got to clean it and you got to do all that stuff.
That is a bummer. Yeah, that's a bummer with those custom liquids.
Yeah. All right,
but
hopefully we lived up to everybody's.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Talking. The chat, everyone was just chiming in with their old memories, their early builds. I didn't even know what to relay.
Cool. Adam doesn't know
and
what
also
you're talking
also
about,
yeah,
folks.
Also I'm, you know, I started by listening to Gordon on the Max PC podcast, so I'm not that old into it.
You got to carry on the torch, man. you got to keep the mythology going alive. That's why I like talking about it with you is people got to know where this came from.
Oh, yeah.
You know? I mean, I feel a lot of this mythology and this history is lost.
Yeah, and it really, we're not making this up.
No.
You would go to some industrial park in Fremont.
Yeah.
They'd be like, is there a store here?
Yeah.
It'd be like a counter with two motherboards, and then it would always be somebody eating their lunch.
Yep.
And it would
always
be like,
smoking a cigarette.
And I just want here to buy this. And they just kind of nod or grunt or something. You get your part and you're just like, is this going to work? Is this stolen or something? It was always that way.
That was always the joke. You know,
there was no New Egg or Amazon.
No, there was Egghead.
There was Egghead.
Egghead.
Oh, that was later.
That was software. Later. That was a little later in the process.
Yeah, that was later too. Yeah. So, all right. Nice. Well, that is fun.
All right.
Yeah. Sorry. We've answered all the questions we can today. We're going to skip the general Q&A.
Sorry. Save it up for next time, folks. Yeah, we'll have Ryan back on.
Yeah, definitely.
We'll just have like nothing but old school day or something.
I love that. I would be down for that any day of the week.
I want to know because SuperXFi, the app is not in the market yet.
It will be soon.
Okay.
It's coming out very soon. You can pre-order the SuperXFi's on our site. So if you go to creative.com, it's front and center right in front of you. You can pre-order it. We're going to be shipping in early January, the actual units. And though they're actually in production now, getting ready to go out the door, the app will be going live at the same time. If you want to get one and be the person we call it infecting, you can infect your friends with the technology as well. It is one of those things that I wholeheartedly, if you're even remotely into audio and surround audio and you love watching movies and listening to music, this thing will change the way you do that. And play games. It's really cool tech, man. And again, it's one of those things where I feel proud that I work for a company that created one of those moments for me. So.
Yeah, I agree. And I'm not kidding. I'm not making up. This is. I'm not just slinging stuff here because Ryan's sitting next to me. You will be in the right material. You will be floored, way more floored than you are by current ray tracing technology, games, demos.
Yep. I would much rather buy a Super X5 than
an RTX. Yeah, if you're a hater, try the Super X5 out. Well, you wait to see what AMD does, and then wait to see what the games brings.
Yeah, absolutely.
Get you through that. Listen to your music. All right. Shipping in January?
Shipping in January. Okay, yep.
And you will be at CES.
We will be at CES.
So we will see you there.
Yeah. And we'll have a bunch of stuff with Super X5 built into it. I mean, they keep adding more and more things. I keep seeing the room build change, and I'm like, holy crap, this is going to be cool.
Cool. All right. I better take us out. We are over time, but it was well worth it because we had to go out. We got to go afterwards, drive down to Fremont, get some computer parts.
Nice.
1 meg Sims. Yeah.
What do you want?
Shady Beck.
Single inline Shady. Memory.
See, you actually sound like one of those people, man. Yeah. Like,
what are you buying?
Yeah. Well, normally you would just point to the ad and we wouldn't even speak to them. You just point.
Oh.
You remember that, right? You would just be like, I want this.
You know what? It's like every single. Like business that they go into in a John Wick movie.
Yes, that's exactly what
it is. I got $500 in cash. I'm going to get killed.
Yes.
It's the mafia. They're going to smoke me for whatever.
It was like an extreme sport.
Yeah.
early parkour computer shopping.
All right, I better take a second.
Anyway, sorry about that.
Yep.
So, we'll go all day.
Check back next week for your fix of PC Talk on The Full Nerd. For audio listeners, subscribe to us on iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher. And also leave us reviews. Every time you do, somebody builds an old school computer. Send questions and comments to thefullnerd@pcworld.com. Thanks for coming. I'm Gordon Ung with Ryan Schlieper. God, I almost screwed that up.
Yeah. Hey, you got it. You're good.
And Adam Patrick Murray's going to hit the off switch.
Ryan, it is always good to have you. Thank you, sir. Can't wait to see you in Vegas.
Rock on.
For CES. See everyone later.
Cool.